morning, everyone. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Tosim. Thank you, Asa, for the invitation today. It's very difficult to go after the legend, Professor Yongguri. I'm just going to try my best. So I'm going to talk about ACL reconstruction. The learning continues. So we'll start off with a few points. So the question is, when is the best time to do ACL surgery? Well, the earliest safe time to do ACL surgery is when the knee has achieved full extension and has minimal effusion. That's quite important because you want to prevent arthrofibrosis. And there are increasing studies to show that if you delay surgery beyond a certain point, 3 months, 6 months, then you increase the risk of new injuries because of the instability. And this has been shown by various authors, Christiani, as well as Mok, and this is over the last 5 to 6 years. And so the importance is to try and perhaps do the ACL reconstruction in an unstable knee within 3 to 6 months, because beyond that, you would have increasing rates of meniscal and cartilage injury. So we talk a bit about anatomy as the second point. So today, we understand that the ACL has broad insertions in the femur and tibia, and they are quite large. They are usually over 12, 13 millimeters on both sides. And because of that, it allows the ACL to function as different bundles. We know the AM and PL bundles in both extension and flexion. However, the ACL in the central portion is thin, and so that prevents impingement. This is the native ACL. And we also know that the ACL is not a round structure. So if you do a large graft and you fill the footprints, then you have to be careful about impingement, especially in extension. So what I understand today from the anatomy of the ACL is that the ACL femoral tunnel should probably be in the AM region, because that is most protective. It is the direct insertion of the ACL and it's most isometric. Well, we also know that there are the ribbon-like appearance, the C-shaped appearance of the tibial insertion, and those are from the various authors like Reiner Siebel and Simelski. Well, the thing is that because of that, people are increasingly trying to reconstruct the ACL as a thin graft and using either a bone patella tendon bone so that the central part is thin and you cover the wide footprint. Well, so my understanding is that our reconstruction or our grafts will never ever be able to recreate a normal ACL. So choose the right graft for your patient. Do not use allograft, and choose your best graft according to the patient's requirements and of sufficient size. We know from Moon data that allograft is not recommended in young patients, especially for a primary ACL graft. We know from the various epidemiology studies, 2014, when we did the Magellan study, as well as the most recent Issacos 2020 study by Maria Tuca, that globally 80% use hamstrings. When it's a more international cohort, if you go and include more North American surgeons, we see an increased use of bone patella tendon bone. Well, the literature shows, in terms of graft choice, probably equal results in terms of re-ruptures for bone patella tendon bone as well as hamstrings. And both give comparable results when you look at most of the meta-analysis and systematic reviews over the last 10 years. Importantly, get an adequate graft diameter. We know that if you reduce or you have insufficient graft diameter, every reduction in the graft diameter increases the risk of ACL revisions. Suggestion of a graft size of 8 millimeters or more is ideal. Of course, bearing in mind the notch diameter in an Asian patient. So how do you achieve adequate graft diameter? Well, look at the size of the footprint. Try to preserve as much remnant. Use tripling or quadrupling techniques to achieve the desired diameter. Well, short grafts less than 6 mm will give you this. That would usually be quadrupling and the use of sockets instead of full tunnels. So you see an all-inside reconstruction. Well, we know that a folded semi-T would give you a graft size of possibly, even in an Asian patient, 8 to 9.5 millimeters as a four-strand construct. So the ability to quadruple or triple will give you adequate graft size. Consider the use of quadriceps tendon increasingly, especially in North America. We are seeing the results of the use of quadriceps tendon And it's been shown to be as good as hamstrings, of course, with time, perhaps as good as bone patella tendon bone. The only issue is that the use of quad as a soft tissue graft will require the preparation using specialized devices, you know, specialized buttons. Well, when we talk about tripling or quadrupling, we talk about short grafts. And if you look at the literature, short grafts do heal. This is a series of MRIs at 1 year after surgery with very, very short tunnels, less than 15 millimeters on both sides in the femur and the tibia. And you can see graft integration and good graft signals. We published a bit on short graft techniques in the most recent issue of the Journal of Issacos. In 2023, the fourth point is not all ACLs are the same. It's important to identify the high-risk ACL patient where you have a pivot, significant pivot, or a pivot of 2+ or 3+ alignments. And so what is the significance of pre-op knee laxity? From, again, the Moon group in 2018, we know that if you have high-grade alignments or high-grade pivot shift, it increases your odds of graft revision by up to 1.8 times. You know, so importantly, identify the patients who have pre-op laxity. So what gives you increased pre-op laxity? Well, this is the paper from Chi Sui Tan, from the late Feng Hua's group, talking about the abnormal lateral posterior tibial slope, as well as lateral capsule disruptions and meniscal lesions. So these three, meniscal lesions, lateral capsule disruptions, as well as an increased posterior tibial slope, gives you increased laxity. So this is a paper from Sydney, which talks about the importance of paying attention to the tibial slope as well as young patients, because the grafts will fail very significantly. Graft rupture increases by up to 11 times when they are young and you have a high slope. So it's important in certain cases to address the slope, and also data on why we should preserve the meniscus in patients, because if you preserve the meniscus, if you remove the meniscus and you do an ACL reconstruction, the results are not as good as if you preserve it and you do an ACL reconstruction. And this is from long-term data. So the next point in 2023 is, especially if there's lateral capsule disruptions or in high-grade knee laxity, at an LET or a lateral sided procedure. This is Alan Gatgood and his study, stability trial, talks about the use of an LET to reduce the failure of hamstring grafts. So hamstring grafts are the most common grafts used globally. And if you use a hamstring graft, consider doing a lateral extra-articular tenodesis. It reduces your graft failures by up to 50%, and also clinical failures by up to about 50%. So how do you do an LET? An incision, harvest a strip, the iliotibial band, identify the LCL, tunnel it under the LCL, fix it. I usually fix it with an anchor. Classically, it's fixed with a staple. This is a modified Lemierre, and then you close the ITB. Well, when do I do it? When do I do an LET? If you have high-grade laxity in the clinic, if you pivot, you're able to generate a pivot in the clinic. If you have hyperlaxity, high Batten score, chronic ACL, high-demand athletes, if they plan to return to soccer, basketball, and in revision cases. So if you look at the first 5 or 6 points, it's almost most of your patients. So in primary cases, I'm doing an LET in about up to 70-80% of cases. In revision cases, probably 100%. So we also know from the Australian group, it's good for hyperlaxity. This is a recent paper. It's also, even in elite athletes, adding a lateral sided procedure protects your ACL. So this is in elite French skiers from the Santi group. Comparing the LET and, of course, the elephant in the room, the anterolateral ligament reconstruction, it doesn't over-constrain, it provides similar kinematics. So I think doing a lateral sided procedure, whether it's an LET or an ALL, in a high-risk patient, in revision settings, protects your ACL or your revision ACL. So consider using it. It's also important to know that if you are planning to drill a tunnel, there's a high risk of convergence. This is a study published, 7 out of 10 tunnels converge. We looked at it and we found that the depth of the distance from the cortex to the tunnel is about 24 millimeters. So it gives you some guidance on the types of anchors you can use. And if you plan to go past maybe two centimeters, just change the angle of your drilling, 20 degrees in the axial plane, and that perhaps misses the tunnel more. So using an anchor is safe. The classic is using a staple. If you drew a tunnel, just be aware that there's a high risk of convergence and you might want to just check it prior to fixation. Number 6, protect your ACR grafts from infection. Over the last 10 years, I think most people are now using a vancomycin soap. I learned this about 10 years ago from this gentleman, Chris Vertulo, again from Australia. And he published this, and it's now caught on, I think, globally. No infections in 1,300 ACR reconstructions with vancomycin pre-soaking. So his contribution has led to various papers across the world, and now ESCA recommends the use of vancomycin soaking of grafts to reduce graft infections. And the most recent paper shows that if you vancomycin soak your grafts, there's no risk of chondrotoxicity. So I think it's something very simple that can improve results. Finally, we talk about the right time and psychology for return to sport. So return to sport is something very big. And well, so what is enough? So previously people talk about 9 months, you know, and when you look at the literature, up to about 50% of post-ACL patients did not recover their strength at 9 months after surgery. So you can't return to sport. We looked at it, and even Claire Aden's group from Melbourne, they are a big group that looks at return to sport, and it says it's up to 1 to 2 years. And even at 2 years, we're only getting about 60% return to sports. We did our own series, and we found similar results, which we published in 2021. Well, if you look at most of the literature, we are looking at about 65 to 70% return to sport in most series, and return to sport at the same level. There's always a fear of re-injury. I think whether it's the ACL or the Bankart, there's always a psychological factor that has to be looked at. And the right psychology for the return to sport is important, because those who have less fear of re-injury would probably be able to return to a pre-injury level, and those who have fear would have a significant inability to. You know, so this is something important. So in summary, do the right surgery for the ACL patient. Early surgery to prevent meniscus and cartilage damage. Understand the ACL anatomy as it evolves. Understand that perhaps the AM protects the graft a bit more, AM position protects the graft a bit more. You cannot try to recreate a perfect ACL reconstruction. Choose your best graft, identify the high-risk patient and address it, whether it's repairing the meniscus, whether it's adding an LET, or in more recent times, addressing the slope. At an LET, I usually do it for up to about 70% of my patients. Use a vancomycin soap to protect against graft infection. It can perhaps bring it down to zero, as most series have shown. Timing of rehabilitation and psychology is important. That's a big work still in progress. And people are working hard to see how we can improve return to sport rates beyond 65-70%. Finally, know when not to do surgery or stop doing surgery. So this last line I added in after listening to the Slard Godfather's talk 2 days ago when he was in my hospital, because if you want to do revisions for ACL, I don't think it's feasible. So know when to stop, and I think that's very important. Thank you very much to all my friends from TOSIM. I've come here many times, many good friends, including the moderator Ed. Thank you very much once again.